Today's e-session will start at 6:15 p.m. Thanks for waiting. European School of Oncology. The e-session will start soon. Thank you for your patience. Today's e-session will start at 6:15 p.m. Thanks for your patience. Today's e-session will start at 6:15 p.m. Thanks for waiting.
Good morning, afternoon and evening. This is the conference operator. The European School of Oncology welcomes you to the e-session 564002. Today's session is, Early Breast Cancer, OFS in Premenopausal Women, for whom and how long. Please note that this activity is CME accredited. At the end of the presentation, go back to the ESO website to complete the evaluation form and the CME multiple choice test. Mastermind competitors will be prompted to start the quiz after having completed the evaluation. As a reminder, during the live session, all participants can ask questions live at any time by simply pressing on the relevant button at the bottom of the page. Questions will be received by Dr. Olivia Pagani of the Riviera Chablais Hospital, Rennes, Switzerland, who will discuss them with Dr. Matteo Lombardini of the San Martino Hospital, Genoa, Italy. Here is an extract of the policy which is published on our website in full. I will now hand over to Dr. Lombardini. Doctor, your line is now open.
Dear colleagues, welcome to today's EASO session. My name is Matteo Lombardini. I'm a medical oncologist and adjunct professor in medical oncology at the San Martino Hospital, University of Genova, in Genova, Italy. And it's a great pleasure and honor for me to be speaking at this EASO session. And I'm gonna try to defend myself with Professor Pagani, which is a very well-known expert in this field and the first author of a very important New England publication on this topic. I'm very happy to discuss on ovarian function suppression in premenopausal women, which is a topic I'm very sensitive to from both a clinical perspective, but also from a research perspective. So during the next half an hour, I'm gonna discuss about two main issues after a first brief introduction on why it is important to discuss about this topic. I'm going to address the clinical available data on the three options that we have for the care of this patient, so tamoxifen alone, and the benefit of adding OFS to tamoxifen or combining OFS with an aromatase inhibitor. And then the second part of the presentation, I'm going to try to discuss some practical issues that are important to be considered when we discuss with our patient one of the three available options. In between the different sections, we are gonna have some discussion, so please feel free to ask your question in the chat, and it's gonna be our pleasure to discuss that. The first reason why it is important to discuss about breast cancer in premenopausal women is that this is the most common malignancy diagnosed in young patients. This is a publication of a few years ago now, but it's a very interesting one because it reports the distribution of all new cancer diagnoses among young women and male. And as shown in the map, by the pink color, almost all over the world, breast cancer is the most commonly diagnosed tumor among young patients. And if we look at all cancer diagnoses in patients in women under the age of 40, 30%, so one out of three new cancer diagnoses in this age group is a breast cancer. And it's true that the importance of breast cancer in young patients has brought international societies, the European School of Oncology, now together in a joint effort with the European Society for Medical Oncology, to organize a very important conference for this specific topic called the BCY event, taking place every 2 years and addressing all the most important issues related to the care of the premenopausal patient with breast cancer. The BCY4 guidelines were published a year ago in Annals of Oncology, and we are looking forward to the BCY5 guidelines after the discussion we had just a few months ago online, instead of having it in Lugano as in prior years. But this is to highlight that this is a topic of great importance for which we also have specific and clear recommendation on how to manage this specific type of breast cancer patient population. When we discuss breast cancer in young patients, we tend to consider that and to think about more aggressive tumor subtypes. And it's true that young women have a higher risk of developing triple negative as well as HER2 positive disease as compared to older patients. But we have to keep in mind that still the majority of breast cancer diagnosed among young patients, among premenopausal women, are hormone receptor positive breast cancers. And it's interesting to note that if we look at the hormone receptor positive breast cancer subgroup, most of the subtypes are luminal B-like subtypes, so more aggressive form of luminal-like breast cancer in young patients as compared to older patients, while the percentage of luminal A-like subtype is very small around 10% in young women, as compared to more than double, more than 20% in older patients. So to keep in mind that hormone receptor positive breast cancer is still the most commonly diagnosed, and it tends to be to have biologically some more aggressive feature as compared to what we observe in postmenopausal patients. Another concept when we discuss breast cancer in young patients is the prognostic value of young age at diagnosis. And we know that young age is considered a poor prognostic factor. Many studies have shown that this is probably one of the largest and more recent ones. By including more than 17,000 patients, these authors, led by Ann Partridge, have shown that having a diagnosis of breast cancer below the age of 40 years, after correcting for all the potential confounding factors, so subtype distribution, stage, treatment, still be diagnosed at a young age is associated with a 30% greater risk of breast cancer mortality, as compared to being diagnosed at the age of 51 and 60 years, so just because of the effect of age itself. However, the most interesting findings from this study, as compared to prior studies addressing the prognostic value of young age at diagnosis, is the result broken down according to the pathologic breast cancer subtypes. And what the authors have observed is that the potential poor prognostic value of young age appears to remain valid only in the luminal-like breast cancer, not in the HER2-positive or triple-negative breast cancer subtypes. This means that probably we should expect similar prognosis between young patient and older patient with HER2 positive and triple negative disease. So age probably does not really matter in that specific subtype. While we can expect that patient with that young women with luminal-like breast cancer may have worse outcome as compared to older patient with luminal-like breast cancer. There are potential clinical and biological explanation for these findings. The first one, and I'm gonna discuss that also more in depth in the next slides, the fact that young age is known to be a factor associated with non-adherence to treatment. So young patients tend to stop the proposed adjuvant endocrine therapy more often as compared to older patients. Fertility and pregnancy-related issues is one of the reasons for being non-adherent to the proposed treatment. Second important reason is that all these studies, including the study by Ann Partridge that I've just shown, have been conducted in an era in which the treatment for premenopausal women with luminal-like breast cancer was tamoxifen alone. And we are going to see in depth in the IESO session today that ovarian function suppression is nowadays an important and crucial component for the care of the majority of young women or premenopausal patients with breast cancer. So we can think that in those studies, young patients with luminal-like breast cancer were kind of undertreated as compared to postmenopausal patients. Third important clinical explanation, young age is also a risk factor for late recurrences, so recurrences beyond 5 years. These are data from the EBCTCG, showing that, again, being diagnosed under the age of 40 is associated with a 40% greater risk of late recurrences as compared to being diagnosed at an older age. However, besides these three clinical reasons, there are also potential biological explanation. Several studies have shown both at the transcriptomic level, so RNA level, as well as at the genomic level, so the DNA level, that there are some differences in the breast cancer arising in young patients as compared to those arising in postmenopausal women. And these differences are potentially related to endocrine resistance and are mostly observed in tumor with hormone receptor positive breast cancer. So these first few slides of introduction before having some discussion are just to highlight that the choice of the best adjuvant endocrine therapy is a crucial component of the care of premenopausal women with early breast cancer.
No questions so far. So we encourage you to ask questions. You were very important. We need your input to discuss better.
Thanks. So I'm going to start with the first part of the presentation, discussing the available clinical data on the three different treatment options in this setting. First option, as mentioned, is tamoxifen alone. We have clear data on the efficacy of tamoxifen as compared to no adjuvant endocrine therapy from the EBCTCG meta-analysis back in 2011. And for the purpose of this talk today, it's important to highlight that the benefit of giving tamoxifen is observed irrespective of age. So including among premenopausal patients, so women under the age of 54, 45 years, tamoxifen has the same benefit as observed in older patients. And indeed, this was the kind of only standard of care back in 2014 with the ASCO guidelines, saying that tamoxifen alone for 5 years was the only treatment option in premenopausal women with hormone receptor positive breast cancer, and then with the possibility to extend treatment beyond 5 years with tamoxifen or an aromatase inhibitor according to the menopausal status after the first 5 years of adjuvant endocrine therapy. However, things have changed a lot in the last few years, and two other treatment options, both including the use of ovarian function suppression, are nowadays available for this patient. I will start with the association of OFS plus tamoxifen. We have 4 main studies providing the evidence on the role of this option. The 2 most important ones are the SOFT trial and the ASTRA trial. In the first study by the IBCSG, more than 3,000 patients, premenopausal women with hormone receptor positive breast cancer, were randomized to 3 different treatment arms of a 5 years duration: tamoxifen alone, tamoxifen plus OFS, exemestane plus OFS. Primary endpoint was looking on the benefit of adding OFS on the top of tamoxifen, so a comparison between the first 2 treatment arms. In the trial design, one important point to be considered is that both patients that used or did not undergo chemotherapy before starting adjuvant endocrine therapy could be included in this study, but patients who received prior chemotherapy had to be premenopausal before being randomized in the trial. So they had to resume ovarian function up to 8 months following chemotherapy completion. And only if they were really premenopausal, they could be enrolled and randomized in the trial. In the ASTRA trial from a Korean group, patients under the age of 45, all of them candidates to receive chemotherapy, were randomized to receive tamoxifen alone or tamoxifen plus ovarian function suppression for 2 years, as compared to 5 years in the SOFT trial. In this trial, patients had to be premenopausal following chemotherapy completion to be randomized, and the randomization was possible up to 2 years following chemotherapy completion, as compared to 8 months in the SOFT trial. These are the updated results from the SOFT trial, the median follow-up of 8 years. Absolute improvement by around 4% with the addition of ovarian function suppression to tamoxifen that was statistically significant. And interestingly, the benefit was observed mostly in the high-risk patient subgroup, so patients exposed to prior chemotherapy, high benefit in patients with HER2-positive disease, and also in very young women, so patients under the age of 35. Looking at the overall survival data and breaking down the 2 groups of patients who did not or that did receive chemotherapy, in the no chemotherapy cohort, no difference between the 3 treatment arms, very good overall survival, more than 98% at 8 years were alive without chemotherapy, and with tamoxifen alone remaining standard of care in this setting. If we look at the prior chemotherapy cohort, the same 4% absolute benefit that was shown in terms of disease-free survival is also observed in terms of overall survival in this cohort, and the result was statistically significant in favor of adding OFS on the top of tamoxifen. In the ASTRA trial, at a shorter follow-up, 5 years, similar results. In this trial, I remind that all patients received prior chemotherapy, so were a kind of higher risk patient population as compared to the SOFT study. 4% absolute benefit in disease-free survival, statistically significantly in favor of OFS on the top of tamoxifen. And similarly, around 2% absolute benefit in overall survival that was statistically significantly in favor of the addition of OFS on tamoxifen. When we discuss this treatment option with our patient, we have to make clear what is the negative part of adding OFS to tamoxifen, so all the potential side effects. Of course, adding OFS increases the potential menopause-related burden, so vasomotor symptoms, sexual dysfunction, as well as sleep disturbance and other psychological problems. When we discuss this option, it's also important, especially with very young patients, so patients diagnosed before the age of 35 years, to discuss the importance of treatment adherence. We know that up to one quarter of the patients, so one out of four patients, stop the proposed treatment before the standard duration of 5 years. And so discussing the toxicity profile and treatment adherence is highly important, not only at the time of diagnosis when we give the treatment, but also during the follow-up visit to make sure that the patient is doing okay and that she's actually receiving the treatment. Now, if there are questions on this part before moving to the other option.
Yes, I think there is a very interesting question from Katarina, I think. And the question is on how you treat women, young women, premenopausal women with lobular cancer, taking into account that in postmenopausal women, we know that aromatase inhibitors are better than tamoxifen. So should you go for ovarian function suppression plus aromatase inhibitors in lobular cancer young women?
This is a very, very good question and difficult one. So I would love also to hear Professor Pagani on this point. Personally, I will probably base this decision on all the factors that we are going to see later in the presentation, all the clinical and pathological factors that we are seeing in the risk score developed by the soft and text investigator. So I will not only base my decision on the ductal versus lobular or other subtypes, but mostly on the other, on the full picture of clinical pathological factors. So in a patient that is at high risk, I will, based on all these factors, I will recommend for sure the use of ovarian function suppression, probably in that case with an aromatase inhibitor as compared to tamoxifen. But if a patient has a low risk, even if she has a lobular biology, I will still go for tamoxifen alone, even though I know that from, especially from the postmenopausal setting, we have some insights that an aromatase inhibitor could be potentially better. However, I think this is a very important question that also will be very interesting to be addressed in the soft and text trial.
Yes, of course, we are looking at that. Remind that this is, you know, a population of 9 to 10%. So the numbers also in postmenopausal women are not so huge. So, but I fully agree with you. I do not base my decision only on the lobular subtype, but also on the other characteristics. So in a less than 1 centimeter lobular G1, 100 PR and 100 DR, I don't think they need ovarian function suppression so far. Maybe we will have more data afterwards. I think that there are other questions, but maybe you were addressing about duration. I think mm-hmm. we should postpone that. I think one question which is relevant so far is that when you stop ovarian function suppression after 5 years or whatever duration, and the patient resume menses, what do you do? Do you keep, you know, do restart again ovarian function suppression or not?
Yeah, this is a very another important point for which I can give my personal feelings. I'm not supported by clear evidence to say what is correct or not to do in this specific setting. We don't have data, and I'm going to show you just one slide to say what is the benefit of extended ovarian function suppression beyond 5 years. So we don't have efficacy data, but what makes me uncomfortable to start again OFS in that specific setting is the potential side effects of OFS. So we know now what is the efficacy and safety of 5 years. We don't know what are the potential negative effects of OFS beyond 5 years. So overall, my answer to this question will be no, I will not start OFS again. I will just go for tamoxifen alone as extended adjuvant endocrine therapy. However, this is also this is also important to be discussed with the patient, because there might be some situation, especially high-risk patient or like some special situation in which we can consider to extend a bit more than 5 years. But again, there are no data to support that, and most of the time I stop ovarian function suppression at 5 years.
Maybe I think that the other questions can be addressed at the end, because you will probably answer more of these questions.
Perfect. So I'm going to continue with the final option that we have, a very important one, combination of OFS plus an aromatase inhibitor. Three important studies, two of them providing the evidence on this topic. The first is the joint analysis of soft and text published back in 2014 by Professor Pagani in the New England Journal of Medicine, now updated in 2018. In this joint analysis, main difference of text as compared to soft is first the lack of a third arm with tamoxifen alone in text. And the second important and crucial difference is that in text, patient that receive prior chemotherapy had to start ovarian function suppression before initiating chemotherapy and not up to 8 months following chemotherapy completion, as shown in the soft study. But also there was also part of the trial population that did not receive any chemotherapy. The other trial is the Italian OBOE study, a three-arm trial, five-year duration of OFS plus tamoxifen plus letrozole, or with the triple combination, OFS, letrozole, and zoledronic acid. Median follow-up of 9 years in the soft and text trials, same absolute benefit, 4% of OFS plus an AI over OFS plus tamoxifen, has a ratio of 0.77, statistically significant. And the benefit that was again observed mostly in the high-risk patient population, so those patients receiving prior chemotherapy. Interest by the subgroup analysis according to the HER2 status. Probably we're going to discuss about that topic with all the limitation of the subgroup analysis. However, we have seen a positive interaction between HER2 status and treatment effect, meaning that apparently the benefit of OFS plus an AI was seen and was observed in the HER2 negative population, while in the HER2 positive population, there is apparently an opposite trend favoring OFS plus tamoxifen. Similar data in the OBOE trial at a shorter median follow-up, 5.3 years. The studies show that the triple combination, so OFS, AI, and zoledronic acid, was superior than OFS plus tamoxifen, while OFS plus an AI without zoledronic acid, there was just a trend for superiority, but was not statistically significant as compared to OFS plus tamoxifen. In this trial, same subgroup analysis with same positive P4 interaction according to HER2 status, benefit of AI observed in the HER2 negative patient population, benefit for tamoxifen observed in the HER2 positive population. Again, with all the limitation of small subgroup of patients with HER2 positive disease, some of them not receiving adjuvant trastuzumab. When we discuss this option that is superior in terms of DFS, however, we have to make clear with the patient that there is so far no overall survival benefit observed in any of the trials. Again, in terms of safety profile, very important to be discussed at the time of diagnosis and then during treatment follow-up. According to the patient-reported outcome analysis, this treatment is not worse than OFS plus tamoxifen. However, it is associated with a different toxicity profile. And specifically, we have more gynecological related problems in terms of sexual dysfunction. And also, as we all know from the postmenopausal setting, bone and joint pain with OFS plus an AI. Before moving through the practical issues, so this is the main evidence on the three different available options.
Yeah, I think there are very, very nice questions. One is, what do you do in a woman under tamoxifen who is menstruating? Of course, you track the endometrial thickness or whatever, but then do you introduce OFS or not? What is the relevance of menstruation during tamoxifen? Because I think that a lot of colleagues, also gynecologists, they are really confused about menses during tamoxifen. So maybe this is a very good question.
Yeah, this is a very, very important point. So the mechanism of action of tamoxifen and aromatase inhibitor are completely different. With an aromatase inhibitor, I'm going to show later on, it's crucial to have a complete ovarian function suppression to have the treatment working in premenopausal women. This is not at all the case for tamoxifen, which has its own anti-tumor effect by itself, so without the need for OFS in all cases. So in a patient that has, in a premenopausal woman with her normal menses that I consider to be at low risk of disease recurrence, tamoxifen alone with her normal menses remains the standard of care. So in that case, I'm not concerned about the presence of menses when I give tamoxifen alone because the mechanism of action is different. So this is again a discussion with the patient based mostly on the risk of recurrence of the patient. If this risk is low to justify tamoxifen alone, I'm not bothered by the presence of the menses, and it's actually normal that she has regular menses.
Well, this is not always the case. So I think because there are quite a few premenopausal women taking tamoxifen who do not menstruate after tamoxifen. So that's why some of the colleagues do think that when you give tamoxifen, you induce ovarian suppression, which is not the case, as you said.
Exactly.
Another very important question is that in your practice, when do you propose ovarian function suppression plus tamoxifen versus ovarian function suppression plus an aromatase inhibitor?
Yeah, this is another question that we probably could discuss forever. So in my practice, I'm going to show as my last slide what is the algorithm that I use and I follow in my clinic. So the higher the risk of recurrence, the larger the benefit of AI plus OFS. So in high-risk patient, I tend to use OFS plus an AI. In low-risk, very low-risk patient, tamoxifen alone. In the gray zone of the so-called intermediate risk patient population, in this specific group, my point is that if I decide to give chemotherapy to this intermediate risk patient population, probably does not really make a big difference to choose between tamoxifen and an aromatase inhibitor together with OFS. So there I'm comfortable to discuss tamoxifen. If a patient with intermediate risk does not receive chemotherapy, there I'm going for the best adjuvant endocrine treatment option, which is OFS plus an AI. So for me, OFS plus tamoxifen is mostly intermediate risk patient that receive chemotherapy. And then personally, I tend to give this option also to HER2-positive patient because I don't see any signal of superiority of OFS plus an AI. Actually, it seems to be the other way around. Considering the different toxicity profile, especially on the sexual health of patient, there I'm more comfortable to give OFS plus tamoxifen.
Well, I just want to make a comment on the HER2-positive disease. I think in this subset, the jury is still out. I think that the main message, as you said, is that HER2-positive patients do benefit from ovarian function suppression significantly. Then we don't know if tamoxifen or aromatase inhibitors. The data seems to encourage tamoxifen, and as it is less toxic and mostly well tolerated, I do tend to do the same, but we do not have data. The soft and text data did not look into HER2-positive disease very in detail, so I think we need to wait. But I think the message here is that they need the ovarian function suppression. And then for the oral drug, you can choose whatever you want. Does not seem to be a benefit on aromatase inhibitor, like it seems in postmenopausal women, but we need to wait for more data. There is another very intriguing question. In a very young woman, so below 35, in who you decide not to go for chemo, for whatever reason, what are you suggesting as endocrine therapy?
Yeah, this is another difficult clinical setting. First, it's true that in most of the cases, women under the age of 35 are considered sufficient risk to receive chemo. Not all of them. And this was also shown in the soft and text trial. If I recall well, around 94-95% of them receive chemo, with 5% not receiving it. And I also have in my practice patient under the age of 35 not receiving chemo. In this case, I tend to use OFS in all patients, even if I consider them to be at not enough risk to justify chemotherapy, but to me they are to justify OFS in that setting. I'm not really comfortable to give OFS plus an AI to a very young woman not receiving chemotherapy, because as I'm gonna show, we have data from also the soft study that some of the patients might not be completely suppressed, and very young age is a risk factor for not be completely suppressed. Very young age and not receiving chemotherapy are two risk factors that together may increase the risk of not be completely suppressed. So in my practice, if I don't give chemo, I tend to give OFS plus probably tamoxifen in most of the cases. Yeah.
I would do aromatase inhibitor plus OFS with a strict estradiol control, because I think that in less than 35, this is the combination, unfortunately, for the side effects, which is associated, but it is the combination more effective. And so, but you need to, of course, as you said, to follow very closely the suppression. So let's go on. And then I think we have a lot of other questions, but maybe we can postpone that to the end.
Perfect. So I'm going to start with some practical issues, some of them that we have already partially discussed. So the first is the choice between tamoxifen and an aromatase inhibitor, which is not really clear from the guidelines. These are the ASCO guidelines that now recommend OFS for patients with higher risk of this recurrence, so stage 2, stage 3, but also stage 1 with higher risk feature. However, without clear recommendation of if to choose tamoxifen or an AI. I think that the step analysis by the soft and text investigators is really crucial to address this important point. And I remind that this score is available, freely available, clicking on this website. What the authors have done is to put together in a composite risk score all the clinical biological factors that we normally use in our practice to make our treatment choice and discuss our treatment choice with patients. And by putting this factor all together, we can estimate the prognosis of the patient and also the potential benefit of the different endocrine treatment option. So according to this composite risk score, we have on one side patients with very good outcomes, older patient, no negative, small tumor, low proliferative, high hormone receptor expression, almost 100% free from distant recurrence at 8 years. On the other side, we have patients with the worst outcome, very young, many positive nodes, large tumor, highly proliferative, lower hormone receptor expression, and in the middle, patient with intermediate risk characteristics. So by applying the efficacy data of soft and text within this patient population, the main conclusion of the authors are that first, for patients with low risk of this recurrence, so on the left-hand side of this row, that did not receive chemotherapy, there is no difference between the three treatment options, so tamoxifen alone, still standard of care. There is some benefit favoring OFS plus an aromatase inhibitor in patients considered a bit higher risk of this recurrence, but that did not receive chemotherapy. And then if we look at the patient population that received prior chemotherapy, the message is what I've already said. So the higher the risk, the larger the expected benefit with OFS plus an AI over OFS plus tamoxifen. Another important point here is to make the choice of giving or not chemotherapy in this so-called gray zone for chemotherapy administration. A lot of controversy around the use of genomic tests in premenopausal and young women. We've recently produced, I think, a very nice review article on the available data in this setting. It's true that if we do genomic tests in young patients, we tend to have more high risk of recurrence as compared to what we see in older patients, but we also have many showing low or intermediate risk of recurrence. Unfortunately, we also know that irrespective of the risk of recurrence, so also in low genomic risk, young women tend to receive more often chemotherapy than postmenopausal patients. But we have to keep in mind that we have now several publications, and this is one of the most recent one in JCO, showing that these tests are also prognostic in premenopausal women. So the diagnosis at a young age is not a reason not to use these tests when they are indicated. And I'm going to go back to this point in my last slide. From the tailoring study, we have seen that in the so-called intermediate risk patient population with no negative disease, there is no benefit of adding chemotherapy. However, the subgroup analysis, there is an apparent trend for a beneficial effect of chemotherapy in women under the age of 50 years, so those patients that we think are premenopausal. And in the more recent publication, the authors have tried to better address who are the patients in the intermediate risk category, non-negative disease, potentially benefiting from the addition of chemotherapy. And what they have shown is that the benefit of chemotherapy is observed most in patients older than 40 years. So those patients that are at higher risk of developing chemotherapy-induced ovarian failure, so kind of ovarian function suppression induced by chemotherapy, there is apparently no benefit in patients under the age of 40 years, so those patients with very low risk of chemotherapy-induced ovarian failure, chemotherapy-induced early menopause. And by combining clinical and genomic risk data and breaking down the intermediate risk patient population in different categories, the authors have shown that in the recurrent score 16-20, low clinical risk, so small tumor, low grade, there is no benefit of chemotherapy, while the benefit in the high clinical risk or recurrent score more than 21, the benefit is around 6%, which is very close to the benefit of OFS plus an AI on the top of tamoxifen, reminding that in this trial, most of premenopausal women received tamoxifen alone as adjuvant endocrine therapy. So we can potentially speculate that we are not sure what is the benefit of chemotherapy in the presence of OFS plus, for example, an AI. Same consideration for the recently presented data of the responder trial in the node positive patient population, recurrence score up to 25, 1 to 3 positive nodes, no need for chemo in postmenopausal women, benefit of around 5-6% in premenopausal patient, again, receiving mostly tamoxifen alone in this trial. It's important to highlight that genomic tests have been developed to make chemotherapy choices, so not to make endocrine therapy choices. However, the benefit of chemotherapy in this patient, I think it remains difficult to be discussed with our patient because we cannot exclude, or we actually don't know what is the potential benefit of chemotherapy as compared to, for example, not giving chemotherapy and giving the best adjuvant endocrine treatment we have with OFS plus an AI. Is a controversial issue. Maybe I'm gonna go until the end of all the practical issues before the final conclusion. Another important one to consider is the need for a complete ovarian function suppression if we choose the combination of OFS plus an AI. If we give pharmacological ovarian function suppression together with an AI, we have to remind that there is around 20% of patients that are not completely suppressed, so for whom we are not sure about the efficacy of the aromatase inhibitor there. Again, this is not a problem with tamoxifen. Risk factors for this not being completely suppressed are high BMI, very young age, not receiving chemotherapy. So if I have these factors combined, as I've mentioned earlier, these are probably not the best candidate to me for this combination. Again, I'm going back to the point of treatment adherence, which is highly relevant, specifically when we discuss OFS plus an AI. We have to make sure patients are receiving OFS, because otherwise we can have a potential detrimental effect of AI if OFS is not given or a complete ovarian function suppression is not obtained. According to the ESMO guidelines, to make sure there is this complete suppression, we have to perform some biochemical test of estradiol levels. This was not confirmed yesterday at the St. Gallen conference, where the expert voted against the regular assessment of estradiol level. Personally, and I would love also to hear Professor Pagani in the discussion about this topic, but personally, especially during the first year, I think it's important when we give OFS plus an AI to make sure that the ovaries are really suppressed and there is no ovarian activity in those patients. Another important practical issue is when to start ovarian fascia suppression if chemotherapy is given to our patient. My favorite choice, maybe I'm biased towards that, but I have several reasons to propose this strategy, is to start OFS before initiating chemotherapy, not waiting the end of chemotherapy. First point is that if I give chemotherapy, I consider the patient at sufficient high risk to then use OFS following chemotherapy. Second important reason, there is no impact on patient outcomes. We know from the soft intact trial, as well as also from our GENERE channel trials, that there is no survival difference. So there is no detrimental effect of giving GENERE channel concurrently with chemotherapy as compared to starting them following chemotherapy completion. Another reason is that we also have a potential protective effect for ovarian function and fertility of our patient that can be of high relevance for many of them. And another important point is that starting OFS before chemotherapy avoids me a very important problem, which is to assess ovarian function following chemotherapy completion. We know that if we don't use GNR channel during chemotherapy, a significant proportion of women develop chemotherapy-induced amenorrhea. However, please, I want this concept to be very clear. Chemotherapy-induced amenorrhea does not mean permanent ovarian failure. Especially in young patients under the age of 45, the majority are going to resume ovarian function, also some of them beyond 1-2 years following chemotherapy completion. And there are data to say that if we start an aromatase inhibitor alone in patients that were premenopausal before starting chemotherapy, that enter chemotherapy-induced amenorrhea, in those patients, there is a high risk that the aromatase inhibitor will reactivate ovarian function of our patient. So to start GENERE channel before chemotherapy kind of avoids me the issues of assessing ovarian function following chemotherapy completion and in the months following chemotherapy completion. Finally, the last practical issue is the duration of adjuvant ovarian function suppression. My answer will be to give it as long as supported by the evidence on these topics. The strongest evidence comes from the SOFT trial, was given for 5 years, or the ASSAS trial was given for 2 years. So both of them, for me, are potential practices and potential durations. This is important, of course, to discuss with the patient in terms of also of the toxicity and to reassess during the follow-up, but I would say between 2 and 5 years is the optimal duration. And as I've already mentioned, I will not go beyond 5 years because I don't have any evidence on its efficacy. The only trial that has tried to address that closed the accrual because it was not possible to find patients to be willing to use OFS beyond 5 years. And still, I will be quite concerned on the potential long-term side effects of an early menopause and of many years of menopause before the age of menopause in this patient. So my last slide is what I'm currently doing in my clinic with the adjuvant endocrine therapy in premenopausal patient. I'm going to start with the composite risk score developed by the soft intact investigators. Based on this score, we can, so using clinical pathological data, T-size, nodal status, KI67, hormone receptor status, I can divide 3 big group of patients, the low-risk patient population. There, I don't need genomic tests to say that I don't need chemotherapy. In this patient, I don't give chemotherapy and I tend to give tamoxifen alone as adjuvant endocrine therapy. In high-risk patients, again, I don't need genomic tests to say that this patient require chemotherapy. I remind that in soft intact, they did not use genomic tests to make this choice and they were very, very good in choosing the right patient to do one option or to do or not chemotherapy. So in this high-risk patient, chemotherapy, and then the best adjuvant endocrine treatment option, so OFS plus an AI. In the intermediate risk patient population is more complicated. There, I tend to use genomic tests to help me in choosing or not he decided to use or not chemotherapy if the patient is not negative. The main message, without going into the details of the different score, is that if I decide not to give chemotherapy, I will go for the best adjuvant endocrine treatment option, so OFS plus NAI. If I decide to give chemotherapy in this patient, to me, it does not probably make a big difference to discuss tamoxifen or NAI together with OFS. And in this case, I will discuss side effects and also patient expectation with the different treatment. And with that, I wish to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Matteo. Very excellent and I think very useful presentation. I think we have a lot of questions. Going back to the estradiol levels, which test, because there are lots of that, which test do you use? And if they are not suppressed with the aromatase inhibitor and OFS, what do you do?
Yeah, this is an important point because it's one of the main limitations probably for not giving a strong recommendation on doing a regular assessment of estradiol level. So we use one of the available assay of estradiol, the one that is actually given by the hospital, so I cannot choose the assay there. In the case I don't see a complete suppression, I just want to confirm that. So usually I tend to check it 1 month after the first assessment of not complete suppression. And if this is confirmed, I tend to switch to tamoxifen in that case without doing other strategies or discussing other possibilities, because the other possibility would be to go for a permanent ovarian function suppression. So the surgical option mostly. However, this is something, especially in the early setting, that we tend not to discuss in most of the patients, especially those patients that are very far from the natural age of menopause. This is not an option that I will consider, different in the advanced setting, where I discuss that more often.
And how often do you check? This is another question.
Yeah. So this is not supported by the data, so I just can tell my practice there. So what I do, I do the first blood draw when the patient starts the treatment, then 1 month after, 4 months after, and then every 3 months during the first year, which I'm more I follow them more closely. If I don't see any signal of not being completely suppressed, from year two, I just check them when I see the patient. So I would say a couple of times, twice a year.
Of course, one of the attendees reminds what you already said, that in St. Gallen they said half of them. So I think that this is because the estradiol tests are not perfect.
Yep.
And so maybe you cannot rely completely on that. I think they are important because, as it was mentioned, 20% of women under aromatase inhibitor and OFS are not suppressed. So I think that, of course, it's random because you check it a couple of times per year, so you don't know what happened 6 months before. But I think it's important that all the guidelines and BCY, which is specific for young women, recommend to test. Another question is, sometimes give the every 3 months LHRH or never, and why?
So in the early setting, especially if I give OFS plus NAI, for the reason we have just discussed, that I want to be sure they have a complete suppression, I tend to use the monthly injection, not the 3 month injection. I'm more comfortable in the sense that maybe patients do not forget to take it. And of course, there are comparisons that they are equally effective. However, I'm not that comfortable to give a 3 month injection, especially to very young women. I just want to make sure they are receiving the OFS and this is actually working. So personally, in the early setting, I tend to give the monthly injection. And so this is actually my practice there.
Yes, there are some data in Japan on 3-monthly and 6-monthly. Yeah. In BCY, we do not recommend routinely because BCY is in women less than 40. If you have a 48 years mm-hmm. old, I think that the situation can be discussed. Then another question about do you consider there is any difference between the different aromatase inhibitors in combination with OFS? Or not?
We have this data from the postmenopausal settings. It's clear that there is no difference between the three different AIs in the postmenopausal setting. We have three trials with the three different AIs in premenopausal patients. The only negative trial is the anastrozole trial. However, we can discuss again forever on this topic, but this is a study in which patients were very low risk, received for only 3 years. So to me, the answer would be yes, they are all the same in this setting, since the most important trial in premenopausal patients used exemestane. I tend to give exemestane as my favorite AI to premenopausal.
And then a lot of questions I think you need to comment, even if it's not the topic, it's on bisphosphonates or denosumab in premenopausal women, I think.
This is again another important point. I tend to give it maybe not from the beginning, but during the treatment course I start mostly denosumab at the 60 milligram dose twice a year subcutaneously. The reason is mostly not really for the anti-tumor effect. This was shown mostly in the postmenopausal setting, but for the bone health of the patient. I think this is highly relevant. We are giving two treatments, OFS and an AI, that can have a major burden to the bone health of our patient. So for this combination, I tend to give it almost to all patients at some point in the first 5 years. I tend not to give it so often with OFS plus tamoxifen, checking there more regularly the bone density. But again, if I have signals that OFS is impacting the bone, I tend to use them. Well, however, it's true that from the EBCTCG data, the benefit, the anti-tumor effect of bisphosphonate was shown mostly in postmenopausal and not in premenopausal patients. However, we have two positive trials in premenopausal patients supporting also the potential anti-tumor effect of this treatment, which is the ABCSG12 trial and also the Italian OBOE trial, in which the triple combination was the one associated with the largest benefit. So I'm in favor of this option.
In BCY5, we included with more a stronger recommendation to consider just a warning about the potential long-term side effects in young women. So I think you need to discuss with your patients. But I think this is a good option. And please don't forget that tamoxifen alone in premenopausal women is not protective for the bone as opposed to postmenopausal women. So this is an additional warning to check bone health also in women taking tamoxifen if they are premenopausal. I think that maybe, I think we covered almost everything. I think that your last slide very nicely summarized what is an intermediate, which is a difficult decision to make. I have a different position on genomic test because I think we need to wait more data. We need to wait the soft and text analysis on that because only 10 to 12% of the patients in the MINDAC, TAILOR-X and X-Ponder did receive OFS. And the benefit, as you said, was mostly in older premenopausal women where the potential chemotherapy-induced amenorrhea play a role. So mm-hmm. I think there we need to be very cautious, and specifically in countries where the genomic tests are not available, which is most of the countries all over the world, don't be stressed about that. Because if you have a clinical pathological characteristics, I think you can, as it was previously discussed, you can design very well what is an intermediate risk patient. So you have the tools also without genomic testing. And we need to have additional data to say the last word on that.
I completely agree on that. Probably was more positive than what I wanted to say, but I think this is very important. If I can just make one point on that, just to stress it again, that so far genomic tests are not helpful to decide the best adjuvant endocrine therapy. So they are tool to make chemotherapy choices. So this has to be clear.
And they are prognostic. They are not predictive for chemo. So they are not predictive of the chemo effect.
Yeah.
They just prognostic. So they say these patients are at a worse prognosis, so you add chemo, but they are not predictive of the chemo effect. So we need to be clear about.
But in softened text, you did not have genomic tests back at the time, and the outcomes clearly show how good were physicians in choosing who are the patients that needed or not chemotherapy. So again,
in most
of the cases, we don't need them to make choices.
I think that I would invest in pathologists and in immunohistochemistry much more than in genomic testing in general, but I think there is a role for this that needs still to be clarified in premenopausal women. We will see. So I think that we are running out of time. I think that we addressed, I don't know, Matteo, if you see any burning questions we did not answer, but I think we touched most of the issues.
An interesting one that I would be happy to hear also your opinion is the lack of OS benefit with OFS plus an AI, potentially because of more high risk recurrences or worse recurrences with OFS plus AI.
Which I don't know where the data,
where
they took the data, because there
I'm asking you this question.
There is no such a data from soft and text so far. Of course, we have plenty of data and we are trying to dissect all these subgroups. I just want, maybe this is the occasion to announce that we are running the 11 years median follow-up analysis, which will be probably presented at San Antonio. And I think one question was, you mentioned that late relapse in premenopausal women. And so I need that long-term follow-up is important. And now in clinical practice, we tend to dismiss breast cancer patients after 5 years. And this is not a good idea, in my opinion, in premenopausal and postmenopausal women, unless you teach very well GPs, gynecologists, and nurses to have a long-term follow-up. So I think that for economical reason, we are trying to, to dismiss these patients, but also in premenopausal patients, I think we need long-term follow-up. Any additional remark, Matteo?
To me, I'm good. No, thanks.
Okay, so I think that thanks a lot for a lot of questions and for the lecture and for the active participation. And see you next time.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, Dr. Lombardini, and thank you, Dr. Pagani. Ladies and gentlemen, the session has now concluded. If interested in CME accreditation, participants should fill in the evaluation form and pass the CME multiple choice test. To enter the CME section of the site, please close this window and go back to the ESO website. If you are a mastermind competitor, you will enter the quiz after the evaluation. The next ESO session will take place on the 23rd of March at the same time. And Dr. Shoshana Rosenberg of the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, Boston, USA, we'll discuss with Dr. Ines Vaz-Luis of the Gustave Roussy Institute, Villejuif, France, the following topic. Patient Decision Making in Oncology. Thank you for participating, and have a pleasant evening, day, or night. Goodbye.